I feel very privileged to be up here today to talk about a campaign, but it's much more than that. It's hopefully a strategy that went all the way to ended up with a campaign. I'm going to talk about the guy on the slide a little bit. He's a lovely guy. He runs a IT shop down in Minnesota. He's been married for 25 years and he's got three lovely kids, and he's a guy who's the soul of the earth. So I'll get to him in a minute. He does have quite a famous older brother, but makes it a bit different. There's probably another thing you might notice on this slide is my title. One of the things we do, and it sort of came from my mum, because she said, I don't know what you do, and she still says it, but that's okay, being in marketing, is actually we try to put titles in about what we do. So you'll see that demand generator is my title, and sometimes when I have to explain it to industry types and bosses and that, I call myself the marketing director. But it is really important for us as a culture. So what I'm going to talk about is a little bit about the Virgin culture, a little bit about the strategy that we did in the last 12 to 18 months, and then how it came through to the campaign. So we'll go from there. This is where we've been so far. It's quite an extensive journey that we've been on since Richard rode a tank over the Harbour Bridge in Sydney to launch the brand, and it was very exciting for us. And it's great to have a journey with a glass of beer on it. But at the end of the day, we needed to grow up a fair bit. We needed to go away from being just a youth brand to actually catering for what is the real Virgin admirers out there who are young at heart, have the entrepreneurial spirit, and really got that idea about who we were targeting. But you can see some of the lovely campaigns that we've had over the period of time, which really gives you an understanding of the culture that we've got and the freedom that we have with such an exciting and iconic brand. So that's the brand Virgin. The next part of that is mobile, the category we work in. We are not very liked. It is just ugly out there. And I don't know if you've ever called a telco call centre, but it is not a great experience. And as that middle slide says, even the tax man is more popular. People used to say, and I say, I'm sorry for the financial industry, people used to say, no, I won't work in banks. You know what? We're way below banks. We're way below the tax man. We're way below politicians and journalists. So I'd just like to right now apologise on behalf of the whole industry, okay? And I'm sorry. But I will say this. The important thing is that from a Virgin perspective, we're the only mobile telco with a positive NPS, Net Promoter Score. So we are number one in customer satisfaction. We sometimes say that that's the tallest dwarf, and we want to be much better than that, and we're really striving for that. But we are under siege. The prepaid market is in decline. Smartphone penetration, 52%, it's way above that. It's about 65%. This will be the Christmas of 4G smartphones, so you can see that hitting 70%. Services are 130% penetration, but really, the stat there is 98% of people 16 plus have a mobile phone. We're desperately trying to find those other 2%. The other part is also that we have to invest a lot. There's over-the-top plays, people, you know, iMessenger, other applications that are getting there that are actually not going through the network and not being charged. So it's important, but at the same time, data usage is doubling every 6 months. So there's a massive expenditure on network as well. The most worrying thing about what's happened to the industry is that 18 months ago it was growing at 7 to 8%. Now it's not growing. It's gone negative. And when the revenue goes negative, tell you what, that's a pretty scary position. So in the last 10 years, not only were we, as an industry, letting our customers down, we were also sitting there fat, dumb and happy on the revenue train that we're on. Well, that's changed, and it's changed drastically. So we had to change as well. And I think we're, as a telco, a little bit at the forefront of that, but we've still got a lot of thinking and learning to do. And one of the key things, when you saw that journey that we'd been on the last 12 years, which was a lot of fun, it was probably a bit too much fun. And one of the things that we did as a team when we came in on the strategic point was say, what does this make the boat go faster? That was the question we asked every single person. And what that meant for us is that we took a story from the New Zealand America's Cup team that every time there was a new initiative, the first thing the person said, they had a big sign behind them and said, does this make the boat go faster? And it didn't matter if it was, you know, it's a toaster for the designers. That means they won't have to go down to the coffee shop and get the coffee and get the toast. That means they'll be able to do it. They'll be quicker. They'll be back designing the boat. Tick, get a toaster. That was what we wanted to do, and it was about generating demand for the sales force to close the demand. So our whole idea was about that. But what we really wanted to do was do more listening, and I'll get that into a minute. That's the first thing we had to do about our customers, because we were changing about, we were trying to get our brand to really appeal to the people that it needed to appeal to. And then the concept of social by design, we're fourth in the market. We can't out-yell any of them. We need to do something really, really special. We need to have a strategy that unpacks what we're going to do socially through the community and then amplify that through media, not the other way around. And part of that is then using a massively big idea, and we'd spent time to get to a big idea before we launched it. We actually delayed it 2 months until the big idea came up. So let me talk a little bit about how we do it with listening. I talked at the start about my title is different because it's supposed to represent what I do. Our social media strategist title is canary in a coal mine. If you understand what a canary in a coal mine does, it's in the old days they used to have a canary there. If the gas started leaking, the canary would keel over and, you know, hopefully everybody would run out the door. Same thing with social media. It's understanding that as soon as something happens on that we really attack it, do that. We have meetings every day. He reports to the head of conversation. I don't know why she couldn't come up with a cool title, but that's anyway, that's what her title is. She looks after PR, sponsorship, social media. Her, myself, he get together and find out what is the culture of what's happening in social. So we're always listening. Because time online is measured in seconds. It's critical that we do that. And then we actually have to know the community and anticipate what's happening. It's not that hard. You change prices, you have an outage in your call center, you know beforehand, so you're able to anticipate the negative part, but also the proactive part. So you have to be really predictive about what you're doing. You have to be interpretive too. You have to go beyond their stated needs and really anticipate what do they really want? What does the customer base really want? The end of the day, we don't get too hung up on it. We sell pricing plans. Yeah, you know, we try to make it as sexy as we can, but that's what we do. So we try to do a little bit more about that. So, you know, we distribute content. We distribute pricing plan content so that they can distribute it through their Facebook pages in a format that they can do it. You know, kind of stuff like that that we've been really tried to be really smart to as well. And intuitive. So what would they like to see? So really smart about having a bit of fun, and this is an association of the brand. One of our competitors sent us a birthday cake to celebrate their first birthday. We sent it, we graffitied it and made it 11, this was last year, made it 11 and sent it back to them and took a photo and then put it on Facebook. You get all these cool things here. That's the Virgin brand, that's what you can do. And that's really, really nice, and you can start to get through to that. It's also how do we start to unlock this on other areas that we do? And one of the big things for us is sponsorship. Sponsorship is a critical part of what we do, and a lot of the spend that we did before really didn't come to the fore because we didn't have the social channels to amplify it. So now we sponsor, and we have for some years, festivals. And if you've ever been to a festival, I don't think I'll go to another one in my life, but if you've ever been to one, the two things that really piss you off are the toilets and the fact you have to line up for beer or really bad white wine. So what we do is, at our festivals, we make sure that everybody registers, just give them a little band, it had a little NFC on it. They registered through their Facebook. As soon as that happened, it amplified a message out, I've registered with Virgin, and they registered to use Posh Pits, which is our toilets in the fast lane, and this is Splendor in the Grass, which we've been involved in for some time. And you know, it's an amazing thing on that. What we did there as well is use technology called Tap It technology. So rather than, we gave away little prizes like a free taco, literally a free taco at the shop down the road, a hamburger, and then there was about one in a billion, you could win a mobile phone. So they'd tap that every time they do it, yeah, I got a free taco, would go through their different Facebook pages and everything else. Only by doing that, they got two shots at it a day, you know, and it was cute. It really, really worked for us. But they're the kind of things you can start to bring out and unlock in a brand. The other point critical for us, and I talked about our industry, was getting a platform that was really, really clear for us. We launched it last year with a character we called Robin de Hood. He was slightly polarising, but at the end of the day, he got our message across, which we were the fairness telco, or the fairest telco of all. And it was really critical that we ran that through everything that we did. But you know what, looking back on it, the mistake we made, it was a very traditional campaign. You know, I think we bought a roadblock on a Sunday night. I felt like I was in 1993. I wish I was. But you know, when it used to be a lot easier. But that's what we were doing, and it was just nuts. So we got the message out there, but still we didn't get our agencies on board and our campaign on board, but we got the platform on board. Then we ran out of money. So we said, okay, what are we going to do at Christmas time, which is a really important time? So that's when we really started to build this social by design idea. And what we did is we gave 25 bikes away. So not dissimilar to the mini campaign you might have seen in an earlier presentation. We had people running around all over Australia trying to find 25 bikes because we thought they needed a fair ride for all. And what that did is that really accelerated the noise through a whole bunch of social media channels, which was really significant for us. And we started to get people to come in off stores and everything else. And we thought, hang on, there's something really, really about our community that are going to amplify the message. And if we can grab onto that, then couple that with the platform of being fairness, we can really cut through. But one thing was missing, and that was a big idea. So before I get to the big idea, the other part of being fair was making sure that our product lived up to it. So fortunately, with my team in marketing, we have the end-to-end, from product creation all the way through to delivery of campaigns. So that's really critical. So we've got everything from customer experience all the way through to who's looking after the social, all the way through to the advertising, plus product creation. And one of the things is, we used to be a bit odd about this. We'd give some of these benefits on some plans, but not on other plans. We just went, this is consistent across every plan. This was a tie-up. I know this sounds like a bit of a marketing blab, but this was a tie-up that went across every single piece of comms, not negotiable. We also then tied in our much more, and we'll do more of this, our virgin friends, and make sure that we've got a much clearer connection between that, because what we're appealing to are virgin admirers who really appeal to the brand, whether they're getting a credit card, whether they're on a flight, whether they're at a gym, whether they're buying some wine, or whether they have a mobile phone. And then what we also did is simplify everything. So we just got rid of all the junk out of our product range, got our product guy to do that. You know, that was really important. I think one of the really important things was under the fairness idea was we dropped our excess data rates to by far the lowest in the industry. Significantly, we dropped it by 100 times, which had a massive revenue hole. But we all went, we can't hold ourselves accountable if we don't do this, because excess data was driving our brand down, was driving all our call center, was burning it, because I don't know if you guys have ever done it, but it'll happen. If you bust your cap, that's when it starts to really hit on, and that's where you get the bill shock. So we dropped it. Massive revenue hole. It was really interesting having a conversation with the accountant at that time. But you know what, we really wanted to drive to a product simplification and fairness. What we also talked about is, at the same time we were doing this, we thought we'd bring on two brand new agencies. Why? I don't know. But we did, mainly because our mothership told us that we had to go through a pitch on media. But the other one, we just thought the other creative weren't working, they didn't get us, so we brought in another agency, and that worked really well, as you'll see. But what we didn't have was a great idea. So we had the platform of fairness. We had this whole concept of social by design, so it was really going to be an iStrategy, but we just needed a big idea to punch above our weights. So what we said to these guys is, we don't care. Ideas can come from anywhere. And it was really important that we had a group of agencies that could collaborate with us and achieve that. And the idea that came is that it was all about rebellion. Rebellion should be at the heart, I think, a lot of marketing. I think it really crystallises your thinking. And I think if you're going to go out there and really look at your strategic way that you're going to do things, you have to rebel against something. You have to be a rebel with a cause. And we had a couple of ideas on that. One of our biggest things, and it really writes itself, is when we went through it, we went, you know what, we're fourth. And people think we're a bit of a youth brand, but we're bigger than that. And how do we get credibility? And someone said, well, you get a celebrity, you hitch your wagon to a celebrity, and you go, well, we can't do that, we're fair. So you sort of get a feeling for what comes up next. This guy. So he was our rebel. So if you've, I don't know, hopefully you've seen him. His name's Doug Pitt, and he's a good bloke. And anyway, what we did is this social by design is really start with a great idea. We will do this again, not Doug, but we will do this again where we will wait for a great idea. We were supposed to launch this in May. We launched it in July. We waited 2 months. We had some really crap ideas that we could have launched with in May, but instead we waited. And the way the telco market works, you're actually better off in the early in your financial year than later in the financial year because you give people free phones. So you're trying to get the money back for the rest of their contract. So it's tough when you have to wait like that, but you really wanted it to work. Then we wanted to create intrigue. We wanted to create something, a bit of noise, a backstory. So, you know, all that stuff that you've heard through the last 2 days really, really resonated with me because it was about story before we got to telling. The story was all about the fact that we were the fairness telco. The story was all about the fact that we were Virgin. We could be different. We could be, you know, really exciting. So many marketers have come up to me and go, oh, wow, I wish I could have done that campaign. I thought, well, why didn't you? Like, I don't know. Anyway, but they feel a bit constrained. And then drive the conversation and then amplify and extend with traditional media. And I'll tell you right now, what we got absolutely wrong is we spent too much on traditional media again. And I think that that has a lot to do with my background and where people come back, you know, where we come from as CMOs. We make decisions that are based on our history. We overcooked it again probably by about 20 or 30%, and that's a lot of money that we could have done everywhere else. So how it fanned out, it was a really planned outcome. It's so funny, people go, oh, they were lucky that they got that guy and everything. There wasn't a lot of luck, if you think about it, how it evolved. We do have our flagship store in Pitt Street in Sydney, so you can start to think that we did actually do quite a phased approach to get this happening. So we created the intrigue, you know, who is Doug? We've still got people thinking that he's an actor. He's not, he's the little brother. We created the awareness and engagement, we announced him, we drove the consideration, the acquisition campaign, and then we started retaining the customers that we've got. And I'll show you the stats in a minute because there were some quite important things. But this now is a template for us. This is how we are going to do stuff. And it's evolved, but it's become our strategy in terms of how we're going to really create our difference in the marketplace. So plenty of opportunities for engagement. We got him in. He started being really, really, really successful. And then what we then did is once he got all those sort of hits, it was unbelievable. It went just so crazy. We got 1.4 million views on YouTube, which I think is pretty much unheard of for the marketing industry. And that happened in about 7 days. It was just, oh, sorry, no, that didn't happen in 7 days. 800,000 in 7 days. It was just nuts. We were on the Today program in the US. Doug was freaking out because I think he understood what WWW stood for now. And it was really interesting because he was saying, well, I didn't think it was going to be this big. And you're going, well, do you know who your brother is? I mean, he transcends celebrity. So then what we did then is said, okay, let's engage with the customer base. Lovely little interaction in the commercials where we say, we'll get our people to talk to your people. Doug says, I don't have any people. So we started off an old entourage campaign on the back of that. So that was cute. And there you are, there's the entourage. They were all launched to the customer base. So everybody's starting to get really engaged. Then we brought him out here. We said he needed paparazzi because paparazzi weren't naturally going to come to him. So we did that. Where was he? So we did this all online where you could really find out where he was and follow him and so forth, which was great. And then finally after that, we went, we've made him a star, we'll make you a star. So what we did is we went out and campaigned and we invited 25 customers to come on a all expenses paid trip to the Melbourne Cup, which just involved limo transfers, helicopter transfers from the race course, a personal shopping experience with a personal shopper in Melbourne, just all the fabulous stuff to really unleash on that. over 60,000 people applied for that, so that was just huge for us. So we started, and you know what? We need to now do an ROI on it, because my customer team, I think it was just about a trip to the Melbourne Cup, so I'm saying, okay, guys, can you tell me how it's going to pay? But they got that figured out. We'll look at that cohort of customers and another cohort and make sure that it does, but really, really good. And we also even renamed Pitt Street, as I mentioned before, so we had all that. And if you're in Pitt Street in Sydney, it's our flagship store, so go up there, and it is called the Doug Pitt Street store. So it was all about him. We had the red carpet and everything else. We requested for the city council to close it down, we had a bit of entertainment around that, because we didn't almost. So Clover Moore is a very famous person from a Sydney-centric point of view. She's the mayor of Sydney. She's also the local member and does a whole bunch of other stuff, I think. But she started to get in on the conversation. You go, thank you, that'll do me. So that was fantastic for us. So we were able to start to do that. So I'm just going to show you a little bit, and I'm sorry, it's a little bit of a brag reel, but I'll show you how it sort of all unpacked itself. Thanks, guys.
Virgin Mobile believe in a fair go for all and want to give Doug a taste of his brother's lifestyle. Visit fairgobro.com.au and help show Doug some like.
Over 30,000 Aussies voted online to give Brad's bro a fair go. So Doug got his first ever ad campaign on TV.
Hi, I'm Doug Pitt. I might not roll over to a famous actress every morning, but I do roll over my unused mobile credit every month. Ha, rolling in it.
Online. And on the street. Suddenly, Doug was getting more Google searches than his bro. So Virgin Mobile brought Doug to Australia for the full celebrity treatment.
Doug Pitt, you might have seen him on the ads for Virgin Mobile. Hey Doug, how are you?
Welcome to the country.
After this commercial, people are going to call Brad your brother, because this is just a really, really good piss take.
Aussies were invited to join Doug's entourage. Virgin Mobile even renamed their Pitt Street store, with advertising supporting Virgin's brand message throughout.
I'm Doug Pitt. If Virgin Mobile can give me a fair go, they're going to give you one too.
And compared to their big spending rivals, Virgin Mobile received more than their fair share of attention.
They're outspent by their competitors, Telstra, Optus and Vodafone, by 4-1 at least. But I don't hear us talking about any of those campaigns, but this one's being talked about everywhere.
Thanks for watching that. As I said, it's a little bit of a brag video. I really love Todd's comment on groom transfer, and then I could have written for that. It wasn't scripted, but it felt like it was. It was really funny though, because you know, I know we've talked a lot about iStrategy and everything else, but when you get 17 minutes on the groom transfer with about 98% positive sentiment coming out of it, you go, oh yeah, well, I've made it. But so that was fantastic for that to come out of the campaign. The results are blowing us away. It's been extraordinary. Our awareness is through the roof. Our consideration, 1 in 5 would consider us prior to the campaign. It's now over 1 in 4, and it's very close to 1 in 3. When you're coming fourth, that's a really, really big tick. Because for us, that talks about credibility, and I think that was the one thing that we really needed to build as a brand. Everyone had a lot of fun with it, but our big point was, okay, how do we get credibility in the marketplace? You can read all the other ones, but that was probably the most important. And then we sort of smashed the results. Our churn is reduced by 27%. We have the lowest churn in the industry now. Activations went through the roof. We had our biggest sales month, our biggest sales quarter. And you probably remember my role as demand generator, so that's pretty important. And our base grew by 25%. So we have now gone from still fourth, but to a much, much larger base. So it has made a big difference for us. It took a lot of thinking. We delayed it to get it right, but at the end of the day, we got it right in big time. So that was really important for us. Campaign continues. So we did a sweet gig for Doug. So we did a sweet gig for you. So that was everywhere. So that's worked pretty well. So an extra gig of data. And then, somebody like his older brother does a really bad ad. So that was good, because what happened that, I don't know, did anybody see the Chanel ad? Yeah. I mean, he can look so sexy. Why the beard and the... Anyway. I thought he could have looked a bit more like the Ocean's Brad Pitt rather than this one. So he did that. We did this, and we put it on our Facebook page. We got... hundreds and hundreds of, and we get really positive stuff like, that's why I'm with you. Yeah, that's cute. Good on you. So it is good. We do get our negative stuff as well. And that's where the canary in the coal mine is really important, because, it's a complex beast, telco. So you don't do everything right and you have to really be on it as well. But that doesn't mean you can't have a bit of fun and enjoy it and actually entertain your community at the same time. So that's it. So I hope you enjoyed it. I'm sorry if it's a bit braggy fest sort of stuff, but there you go. That's what it is.